Is don't boycott.
Roy.
Move that down. Good afternoon, everyone. Okay, well, I'll take that as you're not talking because it's rainy. I receive that. It's so nice to be here. I was just telling Keenan the things that you take for granted as a Hill staffer. I used to have parking, used to be able to go through the staff entrance for security. So I blame all of those things, the luxuries of a Hill staffer, for my reason for being tardy, but it's nice to be here with you all today. Before we get started, today's forum is Educational Success for Black Men and Boys in a Post-Brown versus Board of Education Era. I guess we'll talk about how far we really have overcome today, or if we have. But before we do that, first and foremost, I'm sure most of you know the members are voting. That's what those lovely bells are for those of you that are not familiar with the Hill. But we will have at this time remarks from NEA's Government Relations Director, Mary Kusler.
Got it.
We were corrected earlier on. And we're so grateful that you could be here and are a willing partner for so many of our members and the rest of the Congress. So thank you and welcome.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you so much for joining us on a quite rainy but busy day here up on the Hill. We have been really excited about showing a light on our work on the education of African American males and youth among the nation, mostly because we are really happy to be using this momentous anniversary of the 60th anniversary of the Brown v. Board decision and all of the work going on right now around the anniversaries of the Great Society, the War on Poverty, to highlight the work that has been done so far in the area of educating our African American youth and all of our youth who are struggling, but more importantly, to talk about the work that still has yet to be done. And that's why we're really excited to partner today with Representative Frederica Wilson, who we engaged very early on this work. And also a quick recognition of Representatives Bobby Scott, Chaka Fattah, Alcee Hastings, Danny Davis, and of course, the esteemed chair of the CBC, Congresswoman Martha Fudge. We are delighted to partner with these offices to draw attention to this really important issue, but we also wanted to use today as an opportunity to release a brand new NEA brief, if you should have gotten it on your way in. This is just a primer, an overview of some recommendations as it comes to educating African-American males and what the research is currently telling us. And what we'd like to talk about is that this is just a brief taste of a more comprehensive report we plan to release on this around back-to-school time. To coincide with back to school time this coming fall, but hopefully you will see what research is telling us, and this will obviously reflect a lot of the conversations that we hope to have here this afternoon. In addition, I just want to take a brief moment to specifically recognize and credit the fantastic NEA research staff here in the room who worked very hard on this, our Director of Research, Stacey Pelica, our Assistant Director, Cindy Prince, and then one of the two authors of the report, Deborah Mitchell, who is here right now, and they really deserve a lot of credit for the work that they have done so far and are continuing to do in anticipation of the full report release. And then I guess just in closing, we know it takes a lot of work to put this all together, and I just want to single out not only the education staff for the members who I mentioned earlier in general, but I specifically want to recognize Keenan Austin, who's been running around here. I think she's probably ran out in the hall with Ms. Wilson's staff. Who's done an enormous amount of work here. And I also want to draw attention and to Kim Trinka on NEA's government relations stamps. Kim Thank you so much for all of your work. And she is, if you do not know Kim, she does a lot of our work with the CBC and is a great asset on the NEA team. So with that, I want to close my remarks by saying that we have all had a lot of time for reflection over the past couple of weeks as we've celebrated the anniversary of Brown v. Board, but we also have had an amazing amount of reflection in just the past 24 hours with the passing of a great teacher to all of us, Maya Angelou, who was a huge influence in my own career. And we know that words matter, but actions matter more. And so I'm looking forward to hearing from the panelists today about what is really going on the ground in this, and want to thank you all again for coming out and joining us today. So, Angela.
Thank you so much, Mary, for your remarks and for this work. I'm looking forward to reviewing this report. I have my primer now. So I think we're going to go ahead and get started. As we said, the members are voting. I don't know what number they're on in the series of six. Does anyone know? Come on, I know there are Hill staffers in here. No? Man, anyone want to call the cloakroom and find out? Okay, so just so we're aware, panelists, when the members come in, they will be recognized for remarks. They are hosting this forum. And more broadly, I don't think that we've said this. This is also a forum hosted by the Congressional Black Caucus generally. I know I saw Kwame in here a moment ago. I wanted to recognize the CBC staff for what they've done as well in putting this together with Keenan and Kim. So, without further ado, let's go ahead and acknowledge the panel. Today, joining us, we have, first to my immediate left, Dr. Letitia Smith-Evans, who is the Interim Director of Education Practice at the NAACP Legal Defense and Educational Fund. We also have Dr. Ivory Toldson, a good friend of mine, and also an associate professor at Howard University. Also, you're still with the CBC Foundation? No, just kidding. But was a senior researcher with the CBC Foundation. And what about editor-in-chief of? Yes, he still has that job. He has three jobs. He's also the deputy director of the White House Initiative for on HBCUs, which of course does very, very important work for so many of our children. Also, we have Judy Dianis, or Brown Dianis, who is the co-director of Advancement Project, also seen very often on your TV screens, whether that's TV1, BET, MSNBC, and the like. Also can call her a big sister. Welcome, Judy. And lastly, Dr. Roy Jones, who serves as the executive director of Call Me Mister. At this point, they are going to make opening remarks, and if there's something important in their bios that you all should know, I know they will weave that into their two-minute remarks. And again, just so you all aren't thrown off once the members come in, someone know what vote they're on now. Nobody called the cloakroom. I'm going to do that myself shortly. But I will first defer to you, Dr. Letitia Smith-Evans.
Do I need a mic? I love mics. Okay, Congresswoman Wilson, Congressman Scott Fattah, Hastings, and Davis. And I just want to tell you briefly that at the NAACP Legal Defense and Educational Fund, which is LDF, we advocate for ensuring equal educational opportunities and closing opportunity gaps for African Americans, both men and women alike. And we do so via policy, legal, legislative, and administrative advocacy. And just a couple of quick thoughts. So the crisis for black men and boys began long before any of us in this room were born. And because of that, I think it's critical for us to be mindful of the fact that this country embraced legalized racial segregation for nearly 375 years. Now, although the Supreme Court's 1954 decision in Brown versus Board of Education was handed down just 60 years ago, and some of us in this room may have been around at that time, in many instances prior to that decision, the Supreme Court actually permitted racial segregation to persist, even in the education context. After the decision, there was staunch resistance, not only from public officials and others, to actual racial integration. So today, sadly, the negative perceptions of black males persist and continue to be ingrained in our society. As a result, it's imperative that we shift the conversation in this country surrounding the contributions, the capabilities, and the concerns for black males. And that means baby boys, youth, teens, and men. And to do so, we need to really take a look at the media, because that surrounds us all and really impacts what happens in the streets and classrooms alike. It can affect the actions of law enforcement and also the actions of teachers and educators. So I just want to give you one quick tidbit if you don't know. I think most of us in here know that the civil rights data collection that was released by the Department of Education just a couple of months ago was a universal collection. And that was a critical and defining moment, because until that time, it was my observation that too often we permitted the explanation or the excuse that what was happening to our black men were happening in other states or other counties and in other school districts. But that data clearly demonstrated that what's happening and that this crisis surrounding black males is really happening in our own backyards. So today, the reality is that there should be no more questions being asked, and that our charge must be to eradicate racial disparities in education.
Thank you so much, Leticia. Ivory, at this point, can you make your remarks?
All right, thank you. And thank you all so much for having me today. Thank you to the CBC for convening this. And I did work as senior research analyst for the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation for about 6 years. Very much enjoyed my time with them, and I still have a very good relationship with them right now, but I had to leave that post for my current position as a deputy director of the White House Initiative on HBCUs. And I'm honored to talk about the legacy of Brown versus Board of Education. And I think we've already heard that Brown versus Board of Education was the first time the United States made a legal step to say that segregation was illegal. And we had had 400 years of slavery, followed by almost 100 years of Jim Crow, that allowed people to legally deny educational opportunities to people based on the color of their skin. Now, we know that the courts can change the law, but they can't change mindsets. And all of us know what happened after that decision. There was some very aggressive and violent attempts to maintain the status quo. And there were many other legislative and judicial actions that had to take place since then. And I think there are still legislative and legal actions, court actions, judicial actions that need to happen in order for us to achieve full equality. So even in 60 years, we aren't where we need to go. I think one of the main lessons that we've learned in these 60 years is that integration alone is not enough to help us to achieve equality. We have found that we can integrate schools sometimes forcefully, sometimes through military action, sometimes through busing. But if people aren't ready for it, if people are still holding on to the idea that one race is superior to another race, then they're going to use some creative methods to reintegrate. And we've seen a lot of reintegration happening in a lot of different school districts. It may be reintegration through private schools. It may be reintegration through separate independent school districts, moving to the suburbs, different things like that. And we've also seen within school segregation. So we've seen where even schools that are racially diverse, the suspensions aren't racially diverse. The special education classes aren't racially diverse. The honors classes aren't racially diverse. So all of these are things that we need to really examine. The Civil Rights Data Collection does give us a good opportunity to look into our schools, our school districts, and understand the true nature of where these inequities exist. But in order for us to really achieve equality, we are going to have to start to change the narrative a bit on how we view the problem of young black males. When I started my research on black males with the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation with a series of reports called Breaking Barriers, one of the things I was really mindful of is that the media tended to represent statistics in a way that unfairly characterized our problems. They would look at black males and compare them to white males and just leave it at that. They wouldn't contextualize the data. And one of the things that tended to be ignored in the media is any focus on the black males who were successful. And one of the things that I wanted to do with my research is not compare black males to white males, but to compare high-achieving black males to middle-achieving black males and low-achieving black males, because if we want to understand where the solutions are, we're not going to look outside of our race. We need to look within our race. Another thing I wanted to do was to help us to get away from a deficit mentality. When we look at the economic gaps are much more wide than our...
I know you have a great memory. And I know you weren't a Hill staffer, but I know you know the Hill. So at this point, we were just been joined by House Minority Leader Steny Hoyer, who at this time will bring brief remarks. Ivory, hold that thought.
I have a great memory. Thank you.
Well, I first of all apologize. Am I doing all right?
You're doing great.
Oh, you're going to record me. That's a problem. I can't deny it. No, I didn't say that. Of course not. I am very pleased to be with all of you. Most of you in this room are pretty young. But I went to a segregated school in Prince George's County, just a few miles down the road. It was Suitland High School. We had two minorities, two Filipino young men. One was president of our senior class and one was president of the student government. It's not, of course, until minorities get to be a little larger than one that people start to be concerned and exercise prejudice and fear against them. So unlike some of you who are very young, I went from living in Miami, Florida, and driving by schools that were for African-Americans, and wondering to myself, why don't we have two schools? I want to tell you a little story. When I was 11 years of age, we moved to Florida. My stepfather was in the Air Force. And the first time I went into a grocery store with my mom, and I saw, and I was thirsty, and I saw two fountains. And one said colored, and the other said white. So I went to the colored fountain, feeling that that may be Kool-Aid or something like that, and you know, it sounded a lot better to me, right? And so I started drinking out of that, and some of the grocery clerk came along and said, no, son, you're supposed to drink out of that other fountain. So I went to my mom and said, why can't I have the colored water, which I thought would be much better? And she explained to me that the difference, because we had lived in New York and we didn't have formal segregation, right? Important distinction. We clearly had segregation. It just wasn't de jure segregation, de facto. I'm so pleased to be here with all of you. Is Frederica here? Frederica is walking in now. Frederica told me to be here. And so I saluted. Frederica, thank you for including me in this opportunity. Frederica, we can move. All right. Everybody know Congressman Frederica Wilson, who comes. I was telling the story, Frederica, about when I was at Coconut Grove Elementary School and Ponce de Leon Junior High School and Coral Gables High School, which were segregated systems. This was in the 50s. And how we drove from, when I went to Ponce de Leon Junior High School from Coconut Grove, we drove past the segregated African-American school. But I am pleased that Frederica would include me in this. I'm 8 years older than Bill Clinton. What does that mean? That means that I went to college during the civil rights era as opposed to the Vietnam era. I went to school and college in the late 50s and early 60s. It was the era of Dr. Martin Luther King, of John Lewis, and so many other heroes who marched and fought and spoke up. And of course, some died, so that America would be true to what its promise was. We are here at a moment of both joyous and mournful. We come together on the 60th anniversary of the historic Brown versus Board of Education ruling, which recognized the injustice of segregated schools for our children, and that inherently separate could not, was not equal. We also assemble on a day when millions throughout our country and across the world are bidding farewell to Maya Angelou. What an extraordinary American Maya Angelou was. An educator who put the pain of Jim Crow and the hope of civil rights and equality into words that reached deeply into the soul and stirred our hearts. In her 1993 poem on the pulse of the morning. Recited at President Clinton's inauguration, Dr. Angelo reminded us that we must accept our past if we are to choose a better future. Or viewed another way, we must understand that it is prologue, but we can make it better. She wrote this, and I quote, "History, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived. But if we faced it with courage, it need not live again." Brown versus Board of Education was pivotal in part because it affirmed that the divisions from our past must inevitably yield to a future where those divisions are a thing of the past. However, we all know that the segregation of our public schools did not end in 1954. I know there are a number of you in this room, maybe a majority, that were not born in 1954. I lived in Prince George's County, again, our nation's capital. I went to school about 7 miles into Maryland. I graduated in 57 from high school, 63 from college, and 66 from Georgetown Law School. Prince George's County was not fully integrated until 1973. 19 years later. The poverty line in our neighborhood still traces in many cities the color line. And our system of public education, which ought to be the best in the world, is leaving many young people and too many African Americans and other minorities, boys in particular, which you focus on, behind. So it's now up to us. I give a personal responsibility speech. It's a very short speech. Very easy to understand. That personal responsibility speech is composed of 10 words, all two letters. If it is to be, it is up to me. Or said collectively, it is up to us. The civil rights movement, was on the shoulders of a lot of us's, but a lot of me's as well, who understood that if it was to be a change, if there was to be a better life for other children who looked like them, had the color of skin that they had, that it was up to them. And so they acted. They showed courage necessary to ensure that the past remains the past and that we can move forward as a nation to secure a better future for our people. And when I say our people, I mean all of us. Martin Luther King made it very clear that as long as some people were enslaved, we would all be enslaved to injustice. We would all be a diminished people in a diminished country if we did not change the past. A future where every child has the same opportunity to learn, to thrive, to feel confident in himself or herself that they can make it in America and pursue the American dream. I have an agenda that I call Make It in America. And what America's promise is that every child can make it in America. We cannot do so by gutting federal investments in education, as some in Congress would have us do, nor by eroding the system of affirmative action in college admissions that has helped narrow the gap in higher education achievement. Nor can we do so by making it harder for our students' parents to find jobs and earn a decent living. That's why many of us, with the help of the Congressional Black Caucus, indeed with the leadership, not just the help, the leadership of the Congressional Black Caucus, continue to fight for policies that expand opportunity for all and against cuts to programs that assist low-income families. Our mission is to follow the sage advice of Frederick Douglass. Frederick Douglass was a Marylander born on the Eastern Shore, born into slavery, got his freedom, and became one of the principal advisors, and more than that, lobbyists and demanders for the Emancipation Proclamation, to which Lincoln ultimately listened. But he said this, "It is easier to build strong children than it is to repair broken men." Nobody in this house is more an advocate of education than two people who are here with me, Bobby Scott and this young lady with the hat. Frederica Wilson is a giant in terms of her past involvement in education and her present involvement in education policy. So thank you, Bobby Scott and Frederica Wilson, because it is easier to build strong children. Not easy. Not easy. But easier than it is to repair broken men. Let me end with a little story. 5 months after I graduated from Georgetown Law School, I was elected to the Maryland State Senate. I was 27 years of age. And I was sworn in as a member of the State Senate 2 weeks before Spiro T. Agnew was sworn in as the governor of Maryland in January of 1967. We now have the inauguration on the west front of the Capitol, but then we had it on the east front of the Capitol, somewhat like Washington, D.C. And on the east front of the Capitol of Maryland, there's a statue of a very, very famous Marylander, one of the most respected Marylanders of his time, one of the highest ranking Marylanders in Maryland's history. He was a Supreme Court Chief Justice. His name was Roger Brooke Taney, who wrote arguably one of the worst decisions that the Supreme Court has handed down, the Dred Scott decision, which treated human beings as property. Now, I didn't know it was Roger Brooke Taney, very frankly, because I hadn't been to the Capitol very often before I was elected to the State Senate. But when I learned who it was, I thought it was ironic that the free state, which of course had been a slave state, had Roger Brooke Taney as one of those that it honored with a statue in front of its capital. That was the bad news. Let me tell you the good news. If you look out the east door of the Capitol in Maryland, you look over the Annapolis Harbor, and if you turn around and you walk the length of the Capitol, and out the west door, there's another statue of a very famous Marylander, born in Baltimore, Maryland. And that statue makes us all proud. That statue is of Thurgood Marshall. I want you to think of that. You stand on the east front, Roger Brooke Taney. You turn around, and you walk as if you're walking through more than a century of history. And you walk out and you see the statue of Thurgood Marshall. A little bit of a view of the history of those, that 100 years. So I'm pleased to be here with you as we honor Thurgood Marshall and others who fought from Kansas to Washington, and frankly in a lot of other venues, and chose the best case they could find to present to America, as Martin Luther King Jr. did so often, that it needed to live out its promises, not its reality, that its history needed to be changed, that equality and justice were our principles, and we needed to live them out. Thank you for what you're doing today to make sure that what was done yesterday is retained, and that we improve upon yesterday, tomorrow. God bless you. Godspeed. Thank you very much.
And I'm sorry, I introduced Mr. Hoyer. More concerned about your safety, but yes, okay. I introduced him as a minority leader. He's actually the Democratic whip, so I apologize for that, but thanks to Mr. Hoyer for coming. At this time, we're going to recognize Ms. Wilson, who again was the convener of this forum today, and she's got brief remarks for you all.
wow, this is just tremendous to see so many people interested in this particular subject. I'm not going to take a lot of time. I'm just going to greet you and welcome you and thank you for coming, because I too want to hear from the panel. And I just had a conversation with Representative Clyburn about Call Me Mister. And we were speaking on the floor, and we have, I'm just going to recognize who we have here, and members will be coming in and out. And I do want them to say something. I do want Mr. Representative Bobby Scott, who will become the ranking member of the Education Committee next session, unless we have a coup, which I doubt we'll have. And Ms. Barbara Lee, who now serves on the United Nations. Let's give her a big round of applause. She's our representative. And she is just tremendous in everything she does. And I want to say, my co-hosts are Alcee Hastings, who will be coming, Mr. Chaka Fattah, and Mr. Danny Davis. And I would like to thank our panel, who are all so wonderful and have so much knowledge. And I have worked with each of you at some walk along life. It's so wonderful. And Angela, who is the principal at Impact Strategies and who was our friend for so many years and executive director of the Congressional Black Caucus, she will be acting as our moderator. But we have Ms. Judith Brown Donius from she's from the Advancement Project. Raise your hand, Julie. Dr. Roy Jones, he's the executive director of Call Me Mister at Clemson University. And we're going to have a Call Me Mister in every state before we can finish. I told Mr. Clyburn that. He said, I'm with you. Dr. Letitia Smith-Evans, who's Interim Director of Education Practice at the NAACP Legal Defense and Educational Fund. Raise your hand. And Dr. Ivory Tolson, Deputy Director of the White House Initiative on HBCUs. Thank you so much for coming. I think I also want to thank Mary Kussler with the National Education Association, who will present research from a recent report highlighting programs that have helped African-American male students do well in schools. I'd just like for us for a moment to just bow our heads for in memory of Dr. Maya Angelou. I had a personal relationship with her, and I named a school after her in Miami-Dade County in 1995. And all day yesterday, it was played over and over on all of the television stations, the ribbon cutting. And my son called me up and he said, "Mommy, you were so skinny." I said, "You mean I'm fat?" So let's bow our heads in honor of Dr. Angelou. Amen. She leaves a legacy of love of people, words, and our country. She was a true humanitarian and will always be remembered. And as we gather here to reflect on the milestone decision in Brown versus the Board of Education, I'm reminded of her words, which are so relevant, of the work that must be done to improve the educational success for Black boys. We may encounter many defeats, but we must not be defeated. And I just want to share a little known fact with you. In 1992, I was the principal of a school. It was one-third African-American, one-third Hispanic, and one-third Anglo. And for some reason, the little Black boys in my school would not behave. Everybody else came to school ready to work. They wanted to do everything that was correct. And one morning when I was going to school, I was riding in the car, and all of my personal children went to my school. So they were in the car with me. And I was thinking to myself, I said, you know, I sure hope Timothy doesn't show up today. Timothy was a little black boy who was bad. And I said, now if he comes to school, I'm gonna have to call his mother, call his grandmother, get the counselor, get the teachers. Everybody's gonna have to sit around the conference room table. He's gonna be screaming. He's gonna be defending himself. The teacher's gonna be defending herself. It's gonna take up my day. And I have to work. So then I caught myself and I said, Frederica Wilson, here you are, a black woman, and you're talking about a black boy. You're hoping he doesn't come to school tomorrow. Tell me, how do you think the Hispanic and white teachers in your school feel about Timothy? If that's the way you feel, you need to do something about it. So all the boys who went to high school with me, they were grown men. I know everybody in Miami. I called them back to help me with these little boys at my school, and they began to change. And I personally did not feel that our school district was addressing their needs. Nobody was addressing their needs. So you know what I did? I quit my job as a principal. I was making $67,000 a year in 1992 as a principal. The school board was paying $17,000. And I quit my job and ran for the school board. My mother and father thought I was crazy. I was a widow, and I had three minor children. And everybody said, this lady is losing her mind. She's going to quit her job. She's going to run for the school board and leave her wonderful award-winning school right there. I won my election, and my major goal was to keep black boys out of prison. Out of prison, and to send them to college and put them on the right track to life. And I can say to you, I would not be standing here if it were not for God Almighty, who guided my steps every single step of the way. And those three children who were riding to school with me that morning, all of them have advanced degrees, and they never had a student loan. Now you tell me that's not God. And all of the boys in Miami-Dade County Public Schools, because I put it in the schools, I say, I'm gonna put this program in the schools. And the school board said, it was one black school board member, and that was me. And the school board said, what are you talking about? We don't have any money for this. I said, I don't need money. I just need you to approve the concept. If you approve the concept, I can get the money. So they voted on the concept. Now, what the concept was at that time, I didn't even know. But God knew. And as we moved forward, there are thousands and thousands and thousands of young men who have come through the 5,000 Role Models of Excellence Project who are successful. And Brown versus the Board of Education, we've got to make sure that we don't go back. And as I see on a daily basis, people coming to my office, people spilling their guts out to me, my having to intercede in my district with the prisons, with the jails, helping young men get their HIV AIDS medication, whatever it is that's going on in these jails and prisons, having college presidents calling me and saying, Frederica, can you send me some more boys? My campus is full of girls. They need some husbands. And so we've got to continue to move forward. And I am so proud of President Barack Obama for understanding and knowing and seeing the problem. I'm sure he understood a long time ago, but I don't think he could have said anything about it a long time ago, because I don't think he would have been reelected. So now that he has been reelected, it is our responsibility as a community to stand up with him and move forward on these little, bad little Timothys who are in every single solitary classroom, and throw our arms around them and say, Timothy, you don't have to be bad, because all of us love you. Thank you so much. And we have now joined by Mr. Danny Davis, who has been around the country talking about black boys all the time. When I first met him, that was the first conversation we had. So I'm going to ask each one of them to come forward and say a few words to you before we begin with the panel. You want to start out, Barbara? Come on, Danny, you're going to stand. Let's give Danny a big hand.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I heard the very eloquent, passionate, delightful lady as I was walking down the hall. And it's good to see all of my colleagues here. But it's even better to see all of you here. And so I really want to thank you for coming, especially young people. A few years later and a few years from now, I'll tell you what it was really like in 1954, especially in some places, and especially where I lived, where the first school bus we ever got was a truck, flatbed truck, that the fellow who drove it made it and put a cabin on it and put some benches on it and nail them to the floor. And that was our school bus. That's what we rode on. The first school I attended was a one-room school where one teacher, Miss Beta King, taught 8 grades plus the little primer, big primer, all at the same time. The city that I live in, the city of Chicago, is the most racially segregated big city in North America, bar none. All the kids in my neighborhood where I live go to schools where nobody's there except them. They're all black. Whether it's an elementary school, whether it's a high school, whether it's any kind of educational opportunity that exists. Little busing has taken place, but the busing has always been away from the community where I live. It's never been any busing into it. My point is that many of the problems, many of the needs that we were experiencing in 1954, we're still experiencing now. And so freedom is a hard-won thing. Each generation has to win it and win it again. Thank you all so very much.
Good afternoon. Let me thank first all of you for being here. This is your capital, and it's so good to see everybody here. Actually, reminding us that you must petition your government so that justice will be done. So thank you for being here. Congresswoman Wilson, let me thank you for your tremendous leadership, for your spirit, and really for bringing to Congress many of the successful models that you've been working on for years and years and years, oftentimes the lone voice in the wilderness. So thank you so much for it. Not only what you do for your constituents, but for the entire country. And of course to Danny Davis and Bobby Scott and Hank Johnson and all of the members who have really made it a focus as it relates to black men and African-American boys, education, cracking this cradle to prison pipeline. This is really a remarkable and defining moment, I think, in the history of the House of Representatives. A couple of things I'll just mention very quickly. First of all, Brown versus Board of Education, it's not in the so distant past. I started school two years before Brown versus Board of Education. So I remember very vividly segregated water fountains, coloreds only, not being able to go to public schools because I was black, you know. So I share this because this is in our recent history. And what Congresswoman Wilson said about not going back and much of what is taking place worries us to death, because we see trends now that could, first of all, not only take us back but make things worse. When you look at what is happening now in terms of education, and I didn't bring the study with me, but you all may know this, a large percentage of young black kids now are being suspended from school in kindergarten and pre-kindergarten. I mean, what is that about in America? What is that about? There's a lot of work we have to do. I raised two black boys. They're phenomenally young African-American men as a single mother. Many of the challenges that we're faced with today, I faced when I was raising my kids, Congresswoman Wilson, all of us faced. And yet Brown versus Board of Education, thank God, was in place. But we have a long way to go to make sure that the equity in public education is achieved, especially for our black boys. Finally, let me just say, the former chair of the California Commission on the Status of African American Males, I was in the California legislature prior to coming to Congress. Willie Brown appointed me and then Governor Pete Wilson, Republican governor, to head up a California commission. Then, in the 90s, what we saw was that black males are three times more likely to attend an overall performing school than white males. That black boys were suspended at 20% higher rates than black girls or boys, and that black males had a 52% four-year graduation rate from institutions of higher learning as opposed to white males who had a 78% chance of graduating. Now, this is way back in the day, and I come from California, so there's a lot of work that we must do. But your being here today, your work each and every day, our panelists, Angela, all of the members, let me just say we have to rev it up a bit. And in honor of Dr. Angelou, I have a quote I just like to close with, Frederica, because she really is a person who is in our heart, whose legacy we must continue to live. She once said, "Look where we've all come from, coming out of darkness, moving toward light. It's a long journey, but a sweet one, bittersweet." So we have to continue with this journey in her honor and in her spirit. And thank you again so much for being here. And thank you, Frederick.
Good afternoon. This is a great turnout, and I'm just delighted because a lot of times we have things like this and nobody shows up. So Angela, thank you for being our moderator, and Frederica, thank you for all that you've been doing since you've gotten here on behalf of African American males, Danny, Hank, and all of the other members that have been here or are going to show up. When I talk about Brown v. Board of Education, I first want to remind people that one of the four cases consolidated into the Brown case was Davis versus Prince Edward County, Virginia. There were four cases, and that's one of the cases. But I also like to quote from the opinion because it speaks to how important education was in 1954 and how important it still is now. Because in 54, the court said, Today, education is perhaps the most important function of state and local governments. Compulsory school attendance laws and the great expenditures for education both demonstrate our recognition of the importance of education to our democratic society. It is required in the performance of our most basic public responsibilities, even service in the armed forces. It is a foundation of good citizenship. Today, it is a principal instrument in awakening the child to cultural values and preparing for later professional training and helping adjust normally to the environment. In these days, it is doubtful that any child may reasonably be expected to succeed in life if denied an opportunity of an education. Such an opportunity, where the state has undertaken to provide it, is a right which must be made available to all on equal terms. We come then to the question presented. Does segregation of children in public schools solely on the basis of race, even though the physical facilities and other tangible factors may be equal, deprive the children of the minority group of equal educational opportunities? We believe that it does. Then the court concluded that in the field of public education, the doctrine of separate but equal has no place. Separate educational facilities are inherently unequal. Now, in Virginia, the only part apparently the legislators remember hearing is such an opportunity where the state has undertaken to provide it. So rather than integrate the schools, they close the schools. Prince Edward County closed schools for about 4 years, Norfolk, Charlottesville, were closed. A couple other jurisdictions just closed the schools in massive resistance. Thankfully, we've come a long way from then, but we also have a long way to go. Funding is not equitable. We have disparities in taking money from the public schools and these so-called voucher programs. People say it's a choice. No, it's not a choice. It's a lottery chance. If you win the lottery, you might get to go to a nice school. If you lose the lottery, you're stuck in the public schools with less money, and they're worse off than they were to begin with. There are disparities in dropouts and also in suspensions. And we are still violating the principle of Brown when it says that you are denying the children of the minority group of an equal educational opportunity when you announce an achievement gap, where you educate white children up to the 12th grade, black children up to the 9th grade, you have denied the children of the minority group of an equal educational opportunity. And you can't say, well, we can't afford it, or it costs more, or it's hard, because the special education litigation, the case law there shows that children with disabilities are entitled to a free and appropriate education, period. Doesn't matter what it costs. And you ask a school board member what special ed cost, it is a financial burden, and the courts are saying, so what? And if it takes a little more money or a little more effort to get black children up to the 12th grade, so what? You just have to pay it, because you cannot deny the children of the minority group of an equal educational opportunity. They decided that when? In 1954. And so we have to be cognizant of our responsibility not to reduce the achievement gap, but to eliminate the achievement gap and to get our children out of what the Children's Defense Fund calls the cradle to prison pipeline, where most of our children are on the way to prison, and into a cradle to college and career pipeline. We know how to do it. It's actually cheaper to construct that kind of pipeline than letting them wait until they mess up and then send them all to prison. There are a lot of initiatives. We know what to do, and that's what we have to do. And we also have to address the fact that higher education is becoming a challenge when, 20, 30 years ago, you could work your way through college. You could go any college you could get into, you could go to. You might have to work during the summer. You might have to work 15 hours during the week. But if you could get in, you could go. Diane Rehm had a program on yesterday where the subject was, is college worth it? People are coming out of college with student loans bigger than a mortgage. And is it worth it? Now, when that becomes a question and people start calculating that they don't want to go to college, what happens to opportunity in America? You look at our leadership, just about most of the leaders in America, business, politics, everything else, went to four-year colleges. Not all, but most. And if you ask, you just ask where Barack Obama or Joe Biden or Bill Clinton would have been if they hadn't had an opportunity to go to a college and a four-year college. And we can't have people asking whether or not it's worth it. We have to change the system to make sure that anybody can get into a good college can afford to go. Our democracy is depending on it, and that's why the subject matter today and making sure that black boys get into on the right track and stay on the right track is so important and so timely, even 60 years after Brown v. Board of Education. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
I want to thank those who have impaneled us together to talk about such an important issue, education, black males, very important. And but I must diverge just a bit from that topic to ask if anyone is here from Tuscaloosa, Alabama. Anybody? Well, there's an article in the most recent issue of The Atlantic, and the topic is Segregation Now. 60 years after Brown versus Board of Education, the schools in Tuscaloosa, Alabama show how separate and unequal education is coming back. And so if you take the time to read that article, you will discover a real tragedy that exists in that city where at the current time where the African-American high school, which is called Central High School, is white kids who live across the street from that school are districted into another school zone, which is a majority white school. Central is a black school. And of course, the achievement levels of the students at Central High School in Tuscaloosa are far below those of the surrounding schools that are majority white, right around inside the country club community, and also communities right outside of University of Alabama. And so it's a story of how the Tuscaloosa school system, Tuscaloosa city school system, did not comply with Brown versus Board of Education 60 years ago. They did not comply. There had to be lawsuits filed, and as a result of the filing of lawsuits, they had to integrate the schools, which started around the 70s, 1975, if I remember correctly. So 20 plus years after Brown versus Board of Education. Schools finally integrated, and for about 15 years thereafter, the schools were integrated, and test scores and those kinds of measurements for African Americans began to climb. But then, with the advent of the Reagan administration and subsequent efforts in terms of stacking the courts with right-wing judges, these consent decrees that enabled children to go to school together started lots of fatigue and school systems and communities did not want to be bound by federal law. And the courts have been quite appeasing to that mentality. And as a result, the school system is now out from under federal supervision and resegregated, though not to the degree that it was prior to Brown versus Board, but essentially all of the black kids are going to school with other blacks, and the whites are going to school with other whites, and a minority of blacks in their schools. And so this is a dilemma that society must face, because studies show, and you can read about that in that article, but studies show that when students go to school together, they all make progress. They all raise the bar. And when that does not happen, then there's something missing from for the majority students, and certainly the minorities suffer. So we have to get out of this mentality of I don't care about anything other than my own child. I want my child to go to the best school, and I can't, you know, everybody else has to take care of their own kid. I just want my child. And so, you know, we have to get away from this charter school movement where people think that it's okay to divert money from the public school system, put it into the hands of the private industry to manage the schools, and that money goes directly out of the pot for the whole into the hands of private industry for profits. So that being said, it's always the black man, the black male, that suffers the worst when things like that happen. And so I think this is a very important subject, and I'm looking forward to hearing what the panelists have to say. Thank you.
All right, so we are about an hour and 11 minutes into the forum, and we're only partway through Ivory's opening remarks. We're gonna make sure our remarks are 2 minutes, so that we can get to, through your opening remarks, get to questions. And we have a large audience that is even in the choir raft back here. And so we wanna make sure that we have an opportunity to engage with the audience as well. So because a community issue like this is all about family talk, so we wanna make sure we engage the family. So Ivory, first family member, continue.
All right, I'm about to pass the mic anyway. I think I had spent most of my 2 minutes. But I wanted to conclude by saying that we really need to think differently about young black males. Now, I wrote a column for The Root called Show Me the Numbers, because so much of the numbers had been misconstrued. We had these things floating around like there are more black men in prison than in college, which isn't anywhere close to the truth. We had notions like 50% of black males are dropping out of high school, which isn't close to the truth. You can read my column to understand those numbers a little bit better, but I wanna close on this. We need to think differently about black males. We don't need to feel sorry for black males. We need to be proud of black males. We don't need to look at them as kids at risk. We need to look at them as kids who are our assets. We need to stop focusing on dropout prevention and start focusing on college promotion. We need to stop thinking about getting them out of trouble and start thinking about making them great. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Again, my name is Judith Brown Dianis, and I'm co-director of Advancement Project. For those who don't know Advancement Project, we are a 15-year-old civil rights organization that works with grassroots movements across the country. We've been really pioneers and architects of the movement to stop the school-to-prison pipeline, and it has been incredible work that we've been doing. I want to first thank Congresswoman Wilson and the CBC for this event on such an important issue. And I want to acknowledge the fact that there are a lot of young brothers in the room. And you know, it is a testament to the resilience of black folks that you are here and that you are clearly doing well. I want to just talk about Brown v. Board, because you know, many of us weren't alive in 1954, including myself. And so I don't know what it meant to go to a school like that, but Congressman Hoyer started off talking about Prince George's County, where he went to school in an all-white school with a couple of Filipinos. Well, I live in Prince George's County, and I can tell you today the schools are all black with a couple of Filipino students and maybe a couple of white students. So it's interesting that we have seen the script get changed. For black males, what we are seeing across the country is that they are being pushed out of schools, criminalized, and disposed of through suspensions, expulsions, and arrests in schools. When we look at the numbers, 1 in 5 black boys are suspended out of school. 35% of school-based arrests in the state of Florida, for example, are black boys. Important that we understand that this data is not just data, but when we start to really look down one level, the reason for these kinds of suspensions and arrests and the disposal of young black men is for subjective offenses, for which it means that the so-called bad behavior is in the eye of the beholder. And too often we see that that means that disorderly conduct, what is running down the hall one day becomes disorderly conduct. What is challenging a teacher on something becomes disobedience, insubordination, and disrespect, leading to a suspension. For many black males, they are attending schools where the schools are being labeled as failures, and that those schools are then being closed on a set of requirements that really do set up these schools, which are educating mostly black and brown children, to fail. And then they're being sent to schools where they are being labeled as failures, and then those schools, which don't get the resources, become labeled as failures and closed down. And so there's a domino effect of what is happening for so many children of color. And then what happens is that we say we have failed, or we don't say we have failed, we say those schools have failed. And then we decide to take the money and give it to somebody that is a private corporation. And I can tell you that I went to school, I went to undergrad, I went to business school, and I can tell you that one thing that the market doesn't control for, if we're going to give money to the private market for education, we should not expect that. The market never controls for equity and equality. Mm-hmm. We are not going to get that in a privatized school system, which returns us to the language that Congressman Scott read about the importance of education in our democratic society. Lastly, I just want to close by saying this, that one of the things that we did not fix with Brown, which our two other panelists talked about, is the inferiority and white supremacy. And when we think about what is happening to young children, I really would point people to an article written that's called The Essence of Innocence. Really important work that is being done around implicit bias. And why you need to read this is because it has serious implications when research is done that shows black boys as young as 10 may not be viewed in the same light of childhood innocence as white peers. So they are mistaken to be older, which means that they lose their innocence and are supposed to accept responsibility when they are just babies. And second, that they are perceived as guilty. And in fact, when they're perceived as guilty at that young age, they also face police violence if accused of a crime. It's important because that study also shows not only did they look at police, but they also looked at white female undergrads. And the importance of this is that white female undergrads saw young black males as 4.5 years older than they actually are. And why is that important? Because in my county, in Prince George's County, we just got a really big, giant grant from a developer. And the developer did this because they're taking over land and everything, and black folks are upset about what they're doing. And we got a grant for millions of dollars to get more TFA teachers into our schools, Teach for America. And that means that our schools are going to be flooded with young people who are bright-eyed and bushy-tailed and want to come in to our schools where there are many challenges that are under-resourced as they are, but we're going to get young, inexperienced teachers who don't understand the community, do not understand these young boys,
and who think they are actually older than they are and not innocent. And so these kinds of things have real implications for our children. You know, we have come a long way, but again, the things that we, the core of what has kept us stuck on race as and racism as a disease in our society has large implications for young men of color. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Roy Jones, Executive Director of the Columnist Program, headquartered at Clemson University. As was alluded to in a couple of remarks by the congressman responding earlier, in the South, it wasn't until the early 1970s that integration actually took place. So Brown was in 54, and the court said with all deliberate speed, which we know was of no speed whatsoever. It was 10 years later in 64, we had a Civil Rights Act. And then in the early 70s, when school integration actually took place in reality in South Carolina, where I hail, and most of the South. Well, what happened in 1973 when schools integrated? Black educators lost their jobs. Principals who were principals of black schools were demoted and quit and did not become principals of the integrated schools. Black teachers lost their jobs, demoted or quit or were relegated to menial or custodial labor. Black children, however, were taken by the hand by black parents into the white school to meet their white teacher. And although integration is applauded as a positive, and we should applaud it as a positive, I have a different perspective. My perspective is there's a reason why we found ourselves 30 years after integration talking about a shortage of African-American male teachers in this country, especially in the South. How is it possible that we came out of an era where black educators, black adults were caring for black children and cared about their advancement and development, did not refer them to the office, did not suspend them, did not expel them, which is the precursor to the prison pipeline? Because if a child is suspended a day, kicked out of school for a week, and then held back a year, you've just delimited their chances for achievement throughout their school career at that point. You hold back the kid for one year, you limit their chance, and 2 years, you basically kill off their possibilities of graduating whatsoever. I don't know what data is being looked at as far as achievement, but the data we're looking at from schools in South Carolina, both integrated and segregated institutions, public schools, K-12, black children are not meeting standard achievement levels on state mandated tests. And black boys in particular are well behind when you look at the profile and demographic of each class, race, and gender. You know, our dropout situation in some of our school districts, black boys are not graduating. 4 out of 10 are not graduating K-12. We just had a study in terms of the incarceration rate, and what we found is that it was a national study, that by age 23, 1 out of every 3 black males have been arrested. You know, that's national data. In South Carolina, 2/3 of adult prison population are black males. 2/3, 66% are black males in prison. It's true that there are more black males in our colleges in South Carolina than there are in our prisons. You know, 23,000 black males are in our colleges in South Carolina. In prison, there are 17,000 black males in college and in jail. So there's more, but we've eliminated and created a situation where the pipeline is a real problem. So what I see in light of Brown and equal opportunity is that, one, I believe that Dr. Tolson referred to, I believe the solutions rest in our own communities. You know, I believe that we have the capacity within our communities to solve our own issues. It doesn't mean that in the spirit of Brown, there should not be support on a federal or a state level. But we've got a challenge, not just in terms of academic achievement, we've got a challenge in terms of our value system within our community. That doesn't cost us anything. There's no legislation that the CBC can legislate in terms of our value system. When I look at the treatment between what our boys have toward our women, especially their peers and girls, it is abominable within our community. When I look at the relationships that our young men are developing or not developing with young women, it is not something to be proud of. But in 1954, during those same parents, that same community, you know, knew where their children were in 1954 on the eve of Brown. Mm-hmm. They knew exactly what they were doing, and they knew exactly what they wanted, you know, what they expected them to do. So we've got a revolution that needs to happen, but it's a revolution of values and principles that must go back to the future. You know, we've got to be challenged with educating our community, and educating us not only in academics, but educating back to the basics. We have children that can't read when they enter school. You know, that's a community-based problem. We have young men that need to be in South Carolina, we initiated Call Me Mister for a reason. The reason is because we address the shortage of black male teachers. We're in a state that's one-third African-American, and we're in a state that with 40% of the school population is African-American. With less than 1%, 200 teachers we found 15 years ago were black males at the elementary level. When we talk about suspending kindergartners and first graders and third graders, they're being suspended for a reason. They're being suspended because their needs are not being addressed, and they're not being understood in terms of their whole development. So we looked at the shortage of black males. 1%, that's 200 out of over 20,000 teachers serving in over 600 elementary schools. 200. 1%. And suspension, expulsion, and dropout rates are through the roof when it comes to black males and black children in particular, in general. We decided we needed to have black male mentors, role models, teacher leaders in front of the classrooms in South Carolina. And we believe that by placing black men in front of a classroom teaching first graders and third graders how to read and write and feel good about themselves and feel good about coming to school and see themselves as part of a proud tradition where education was basically fought for generations. It should be no surprise that 60 years after Brown, we're still struggling with some of the same issues. Hell, Brown took, you know, 2 decades. Brown didn't just happen overnight. Brown was a series of cases that started in the 30s. Thank God for the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. In the 30s. And then the cases were consolidated, including the South Carolina case, Briggs versus Elliott in Clarendon County, where parents were out front. Parents stepped up, signed their name to a petition, begged Thurgood Marshall not to go away to fight in the Briggs case. Then Mr. Briggs had to leave town, had to leave his beloved South Carolina, had to be run out because they were signing a death warrant when they signed that petition saying that we want a bus in Clarendon County.
So Dr. Jones, if you could pause right there. I know you're passionate about this, and I think the whole room is. So we want to give everyone an opportunity to be able, well, not everyone will be able to ask questions. We're going to start with questions now. You just walked down a road, and this is kind of where I stopped you because I didn't want you to take my question. Down the road of kind of a constitutional law issue. Thank you so much, Congresswoman Lee. Constitutional law place. And this is also, I think, where Judy was going. And so I want to start with challenging the very premise of today's forum, which is educational success for black men and boys in a post-Brown versus Board of Education era. Why are we starting there? Because from everything that you all have said, it sounds like in order to pursue and to achieve educational success, there are some other things that have to be challenged. So Congressman Johnson brought up a piece from The Atlantic challenging the fact that years after Brown versus Board, and really this is a Plessy versus Ferguson argument, whether there was ever separate but equal. This was really a separate but unequal thing, which is a 118-year-old problem, right? That case preceded Brown by 58 years. And still today, we're struggling with separate and unequal facilities, whether it's educational facilities, jails, places, housing accommodations, et cetera. But Judy then went on to talk about the perception or implicit bias and perception of guilt and age, how old our children are. So all of these things, I can't help but to cite a Plessy line from Justice Henry Billings Brown, and I think this really gives a good foundation, and I want you all to respond to this. In writing the majority opinion, Justice Brown says, the object of the 14th Amendment was undoubtedly to enforce the equality of the two races before the law, but in the nature of things, it could not have been intended to abolish distinctions based upon color or to endorse social as distinguished from political equality. If one race be inferior to the other socially, the Constitution of the United States cannot put them upon the same plane. And here we are today, 60 years after Brown, second affirmative action case before SCOTUS struck down as unconstitutional. But there is implicit bias behind all of these decisions. We even heard our Attorney General, right, addressing Morgan State University's commencement, talking about that kind of bias. He's like, forget Clive and Bundy and Donald Sterling. You need to be worried about why your kids can't get good textbooks. So I want us to talk about, just for a minute, what kinds of things do we really need to be working on to not only ensure educational success, but really holistic success for African American boys? And we can start wherever. Sure.
I can take a stab at it. I think implicit bias is something that is very, very important for us to look at. And you know, we're a majority black crowd in this room right here. And I think, you know, I'm amongst family when I say that we need to look at implicit bias among ourselves first. And when we look at counties like Prince George's County, that reads every outside report about Prince George's County, and you have it's the most affluent, predominantly black county in the entire United States. But it's also a county where you have these affluent black families that's afraid to send their children to their own public schools. And why are they afraid? Oftentimes they're not afraid because of fighting or because of gangs or because of anything that anybody should be afraid of. They're afraid because some outside evaluators come in and said that they have low test scores, that you know only 60% are proficient in that school compared to 75% in Montgomery County. So they'd rather send their kids to Montgomery County so these 35% of kids won't rub off on them. But these are black kids just like their kids are. So we need to challenge ourselves and the way that we look at ourselves. We also need to challenge the reports that we believe. There is something I put on Twitter that was pretty popular last week, and it was black people need black people who believe in black people enough not to believe every bad thing they hear about black people. Now, things
like...
That
wasn't under 140 characters.
So if you read something like 50% of black males are arrested by the time they are 23, these are things we need to look at first before we trust it. That was written by a professor at University of South Carolina. And it's a horrible study. You can read my article in The Root. I ripped it apart. 50% of us are not going to get arrested. But when we repeat things like that, you know, we want these young white teachers to believe in our black males, but then we go and tell them that 50% are going to drop out and 50% are going to get arrested. I would be afraid of white girls if somebody told me that about them. And if it's true, we need to deal with the truth. But where it's false, we need to strike it out from our narrative, because this is a narrative that's not serving our young black males very well.
Okay, I just wanted to take it back a step, because Angela mentioned Plessy versus Ferguson, and we heard Congressman Hoyer mention Dred Scott, which came decades before. if you don't know. And the decision that he was referencing, written by Justice Taney, actually said, had the language that said that African Americans cannot be citizens of the United States. So that's really the foundation on which, you know, we built this country. And obviously, education is part of that. So today, with respect to Brown, although the decision came down in 54 and in 55, as Dr. Jones mentioned, there was an order from the court to desegregate with all deliberate speed, there are 300 school systems that are still under court order to desegregate throughout this country. The majority of those districts are in the South. Now, I just want to address a point about what it means to desegregate. So Brown was not just about who's sitting next to whom in the classroom. Today, when we, and LDF, the Legal Defense Fund, still litigates a number of these, about 100 of these desegregation cases throughout the South, we look at the Supreme Court's guidance that came about 14 years post-Brown, and that was in the Green decision, that talks about the factors that a school system should look to when it's assessing whether or not it has eliminated what they call the vestiges of the de jure, or legalized segregated system. So we're looking at the facilities. We do look at whether or not if the schools are segregated and there's an African American or black school and a white school, what do the facilities look like? And I can tell you, they look nothing alike. I am on the ground with my colleagues in some of these places in Tennessee and Mississippi and elsewhere, and we always bring community members and parents to on school site visits. I can't tell you how many times there are tears in their eyes when they see the facilities of students, white students, as compared to the facilities of the African-American students. And if you ever want to see slides, I have plenty of pictures to show you. But when you talk about data, and this is something that you can see, if you look at some of these school systems in the Civil Rights Data Collection, you will see in a school system that is more than 50% African-American, not one student is enrolled, for example, in a gifted and talented program, at which the entry point is kindergarten. That does not make any sense. Like, there is something wrong. And in terms of the issue that we need to address, is really about institutionalized racism. We, you know, have perceptions about who's best suited to teach our child. And I agree with many of those, and I'm a former public elementary school teacher. But the fact of the matter is, when you have a superintendent or a school board that permits or endorses what I consider to be institutionalized racism, or they endorse actions that result in racial disparities, then that's a problem. That means that where there are African American teachers or other teachers of color, regardless of their race, that they may be forced or required to do things that they otherwise should not be doing, would not be doing, because they are wrapped up in a system that does not support African American students. And I just wanted two more quick things. The study, so in case you want to pull it up, that Judy was talking about, is very recent, which is very sad. It's 2014. Dr. Phil Goff is one of the main authors of that study. And so I'll leave it there for now, but have other comments.
So I wanted to just add, I think one of the things that we have to talk about in this post-Brown world is, like, what is the, this is really like the third generation now. So the new, you know, in the work that we do, the new generation of Brown issues really is around school closings. You know, just the week of Brown versus Board of Education anniversary, Advancement Project filed Title VI complaints under the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which prohibits discrimination in the use of federal funds. And we filed those Title VI complaints on behalf of a school in Chicago called Diet High School. And actually the kids who go there, and then kids who go to school in New Orleans, and also in Newark, New Jersey. Because what we are finding is the siphoning off of funds from the public schools to charter schools really is creating a real crisis in public schools. And that, unfortunately, children of color are the ones who are on the receiving end of that. And so, for example, in Chicago, Diet High School is a school that has been phased out, is being phased out over a period of time. There are now only 69 students left in that school. They have, and they're supposed to close next year. And so out of that 69, they have to take phys ed online. They have to take art online. The school received a few years ago a $4 million grant from ESPN to redo their gym. And in fact, it has been redone. It is, you know, state of the art, but the students cannot use it. Only the administrators can use it. And the idea is that that is a school that is going through a phase out because of gentrification in the Bronzeville area, which is a historic Black neighborhood in Chicago. And the idea, people think that what is going to happen is that a charter is basically going to get ready to take over that school. But if you could imagine, there's that school, and then there's a school that is Mollison Elementary, where children, where that is a receiving school of a closed elementary. And what happened was that those kids are being sent, kids are being sent to that school. Now we're overcrowded in that school. Now that school actually is on the list for future closing. The school, so these kids are being sent from school to school to school to school, never being able to develop relationships with adults, never being able to be cared for by teachers, by administrators, and being literally, when they are sent, everyone in the building, all the adults know that kid is coming from that failing school, and they are labeled. And so as we look at the loss of the public good of public education, it is going to hardest hit children of color. And so we filed these Title VI complaints with the Department of Justice and the Department of Education. You know, the problem is that we have federal policies that are allowing this to happen, and we have state and local policies that are allowing it to happen, and there's a lot of money on the table. And that money isn't for those children who are going to those schools. And so I think we've got to be thinking about what is the next iteration of Brown that is so familiar. You know, when I was looking at some of these pictures of, you know, that you have up here from 1954, it's really eerie. If I change the clothes on the kids, it'd be the same. It would be the same. And so I think, you know, we got to be thinking about where we are right now and what are the lessons that we have learned from the past. But we, and the thing is that community has got to be at the forefront of changing this and pushing on federal policies, on local policies, to do the right things by our kids.
Dr. Jones, did you have a comment on this?
Yeah, I want to speak to the partnership. We were talking about the possibility of states stepping up. Clemson, for example, is a land-grant Division I institution that has partnered with all of the HBCUs in South Carolina to formulate a coalition to develop Black male teachers in the state. That coalition has grown from 4 institutions to now 18 institutions in the state, including all the HBCUs that are accredited teacher education programs, and as well as this, HWCUs, historically white institutions in the state. There's been most of the funding and the commitment now comes from the state, although it's been a public and private partnership, and it's developed as one for the last 14 years. It has really been a commitment on behalf of both the state and the institutions of higher ed to address one of the systemic problems in the state, and that is the development of African American males from an educational standpoint in developing educators. And more specifically, at the early child first step level, so at the elementary, early child, middle grades level, we believe the problem is fundamental, and we have to address it as a fundamental problem. Reading scores and math scores for Black children are, you know, Black children are behind 2 and 3 grade levels by the time they hit middle grades. So we know that the intervention has to be at the early stages. The partnership at the institutional level is a public and private partnership, and it's generating support on both from both private foundations and the state itself, with the largest commitment being from the state. For example, just over $13 million has gone into direct student aid for development of black male teachers in South Carolina, with half of that going to HBCUs in the state. We've graduated 150 fully certified and degreed black males that are majoring at the middle and at the primarily at the elementary and middle grade level, with another 160 in the pipeline from freshmen, the master's candidates. We would have virtually doubled the number of black males that we found back in 2000 by the upcoming year. And that's been a long-term sustainable effort. So we look at policy and you look at the positive responses from both a media and a public relations standpoint. The commitment has been cross-racial and biracial commitments, and it's been both community as well as educational commitments. I think it's as close as we've been able to come in the last 25 years to addressing what has been a trend in the state in terms of the achievement level of black males at the early grades.
So when we talk about educational success and we think about what goes into play, there's time and effort from parents and general community members, educators, et cetera, but there's also resources, financial specifically. Dr. Jones, you just mentioned public-private partnerships, and I think one other thing we really need to layer onto this is other federal, state, and local resources at play. This is probably a little controversial, but I'm going to bring it up anyway. We have capacity challenges at our institutions, whether they're HBCUs or schools that are in neighborhoods that are overwhelmingly dominated by people of color, because there's an income gap that we talk about, and especially the CBC knows all too well as the conscience of the Congress laboring on behalf of these folks for years and years. So one group that's been particularly hit very hard are HBCU students and students of color at other or other institutions because of administration policy changes to PLUS loans. Again, I know this is controversial, but we've got to be fair and talk about all these things. So not only as it relates to PLUS loans, in case you can't speak on it, Ivory, I'm going to defend you right here, but as kind of a barrier, but are there other things that we need to be thinking about? What policy changes do we sometimes put on the table that create more of an issue for our students and their parents who have resource issues? I know, for example, Call Me Mister, you know, you're working with people who give back to these kids and ensure that they have community members that reflect to them positively what it means to be a black man. But if you have all that done and you still can't go to school, we have the challenges that Mr. Scott talked about with, is it even worth it because I can't afford it? Your parents don't qualify for loans. You don't qualify for loans. I know for me, I had to get some co-signers on my student loans, and Mr. Scott, sometimes I still debate on whether or not it was worth it. After law school. But if I would love to hear from some of you. And again, Ivory doesn't have to speak to PLUS loans, but I definitely want somebody to do that.
Yeah. I guess if anybody should talk about it, I should.
I was trying to help.
But but PLUS loans right now are going through negotiated rulemaking, and the negotiation has come to a conclusion and consensus has been reached. I'm not at liberty to talk about what has been reached. But you should see some an update on that very quickly. But the broader question is about resources. How do we create opportunities for all children, all young adults to be able to achieve their dreams and go to college? I spent my career at HBCUs, at Southern University in Baton Rouge first and at Howard University until I came to the White House initiative. So I know the value of HBCUs. And I was very happy to hear Dr. Jones talk about the collaborations that he has with HBCUs, because being an HBCU faculty, I found very valuable collaborations with University of Georgia, University of Michigan, and Emory University, which helped to help me to build up a lot of my skills and bring it back to the students that I have. The challenges, one of the main challenges that I think HBCUs have right now is, one, the pipeline coming into HBCUs. We have the majority of students of color right now are graduating from high schools that don't offer physics and calculus. And when you look at the recent data from the Civil Rights Data Collection, we find that about 35% of schools that enroll the highest percentage of Black and Latino kids don't have Algebra 2. There are students who are high-performing students who can finish all of their math classes by their sophomore year of high school and have no math at all between for 2 years until they get to college. And this is a huge burden for HBCUs. One of the things that we're trying to encourage HBCUs to do, and we have our own initiative called HBCUs Are My Brother's Keeper, which is a companion initiative to President Obama's My Brother's Keeper initiative. And one of the things that we want HBCUs to do is to be more actively involved in the educational issues that surrounds their schools. Because when I look at you know, a school like Jackson State, which is situated in Jackson, Mississippi, according to the Civil Rights Data Collection, there were twice as many kids who were referred to criminal justice or to law enforcement than was taking physics and calculus. So HBCUs need to be in a position to not only advocate but actively intervene by maybe offering these classes on their campus, setting up community colleges, are setting up AP classes, different opportunities like that for students. Other issues related to HBCUs have to do with them not being as competitive in getting a lot of the federal competitive grants. And that's another thing that we're working on through the initiative. But we also know that there's a lot of cronyism in a lot of these processes too. And some of that cronyism comes from schools educating, colleges educating their faculty members to get on these boards and to go to Washington and different things like that. So it's a culture in the way that they do business that some HBCUs haven't really caught on to. So there's a lot of barriers that we need to try to break here at the federal level, but there's also different things that we need to advise the HBCUs on so they could strategize a little bit better in this regard.
You know, historically, HBCUs have taken all comers. They've been open door admission policies. So if you graduated from high school, you had a place to go to college. That's been positive for the community. But when you look at, if you throw in another federal policy, I'm hearing now recently the federal government is planning to grade colleges and universities in this country, giving them an A, B, C, D, E, or F grade. It's not that I don't want to hasten to say that HBCUs will suddenly find themselves in trouble with that system, but I would definitely would want to look very carefully about how would there be an adverse impact on HBCUs with that grading system, given the nature of its clientele, which hasn't really changed in the current generation since Brown. If it wasn't for HBCUs, many students simply would not have a place to go. So there almost needs to be an intentional double standard, if you will, in recognizing the value of an historic nature of the HBCUs and their future value, and also, you know, preparing students for the new generation of we're trying to prepare students to be in the global society. But that would be one that I would be very concerned about and very watchful about in terms of this grading system of colleges and universities nationwide.
I can address the grades if you all are interested in hearing about
briefly, because I have one more question and your family members want to ask
questions. Very briefly. Right now, there are outside entities that are already grading our universities. U.S. News and World Report is probably the most prominent. And they are grading colleges based on their selectivity. They are grading colleges on a lot of the glitter that goes into colleges that have a lot of money. So one of the things that the federal government wants to do is to have a competing grading system that grades based on the value of that college. Now, historically, according to the mission of HBCUs, we are the schools that purport that we can take students that don't have strong academic credentials, that require Pell Grants and bring them to a place where they can compete with the best and the brightest. And HBCUs have done that. If you look at a recent ranking by NSF, you'll find that the top 10 schools for producing African Americans who go on to get PhDs in STEM are HBCUs. When you get into the top 25, you get schools like Harvard and MIT breaking in there. But this is a list where you can see Jackson State University placed right above Harvard University. And so we know that HBCUs can compete in that regard. There are a lot of things that we are advising and we are looking at with the grading system to make sure that it's not unfair to HBCUs. But we are optimistic, and I think all of us should be optimistic, that we can get a system that can finally reward HBCUs on the value that they bring. And where you all see that that might not happen, let your voice be heard, because we do need to make sure that it captures what HBCUs do best before it becomes public.
So Ivory, the first order of business is challenging what value means. Sorry, like you need to start with the definition of value, because that can mean a lot of different things. Yeah. Uh-oh, I have to defer to Mr. Davis. Yes, sir.
It seems to me that charter schools are gaining more and more acceptance. And I'm afraid that the same thing is happening with African American teachers and principals and other personnel with charter school development that took place with African American professionals who were let out, fired, cut loose, couldn't get a job. In my city, we just closed 50 schools. Well, we didn't, the mayor did. The mayor did. And I'm trying, I hear all of these discussions that I participate in and go to. You mentioned Mollison, and I was thinking of the fact that one of our most prominent citizens actually gained her reputation as the parent leader at Mollison, a woman named Dorothy Tillman, who became a member of the city council, has a radio show now, developed the Harold Washington Center, all kinds of stuff. Where do we get the impetus? I mean, nobody seemed to really be much opposed to further development of charter schools when they closed these other schools, they fired that. I'm saying it's not, I know hundreds of African American educators who have lost their jobs in the last 4 or 5 years after having taught 15, 20 years, can't find a job, nothing approaching what they were doing. Nobody seemed to really care except the teachers' unions. I'm saying nobody else seemed to have much interest in this development. Where does it start? I mean, that's kind of.
But I think the. Thank you for the question. The verdict is still out on charter schools, but we begin to get information now that suggests that charter schools aren't the silver bullet, because you've got both public and you've got both private charter schools, and you know, some of them are doing well and some of them are not doing well. And it's kind of like the public-private argument, you know, is that, you know, there's a common feeling or belief that private schools, because they're private, outdistance public schools. And it's kind of the same aura that charter schools are developing, but you know, it's a mixed bag. Where we are, you know, charter schools are not outdistancing public schools in terms of academic performance and achievement of students, and many of them are run very badly. Part of the reason why they become charter schools is because they're unregulated, so you know, the accountability is not the same at the same level. And honestly, most black children aren't attending charter schools. That's not where they are. So I just think that we, again, need to be careful, especially when we're talking about the privatization of our public system and what the implications of that are.
So I think one of the things that we have to think about is that charter schools actually started with good intent, right? They were supposed to be these schools that were for creative, to create a creative environment where teachers could do something different. Where we have gone wrong is that we now see them as the competitor to the public school system. And the way that this plays out, and it's very interesting because this is the way that we dismantle public goods, is this is exactly the same story with public housing. First, you don't give it enough money, and you say, you disinvest, then you say it is failing. It's not doing good. No public housing, no one should live there. Public schools, no one should go to school there. And that was your responsibility, right, as the mayor, Emmanuel, to make sure, and in Newark, you know, to make sure that in fact the schools were doing well. Newark, it's the state. The state took over the school district, and now they're saying, okay, you know, let's just give the schools away. And you're not only just giving the schools away, but you're actually giving away brick and mortar. That's the thing. I mean, like, literally giving away buildings to private institutions without payment for it, right? And so then what we do is we give them away. We now have less money for the public school system because you didn't create new money for this. This is using the old money. What we see, in especially in places like Chicago, where what happens is a child goes to the charter school, gets expelled because their expulsion rates and suspension rates are higher than what we're seeing in public schools, and so they get expelled. That money does not follow them back to that public school when they get kicked out, right? In New Orleans, we see kids on the street who have no place to go because the traditional public schools now all have some kind of admissions policy for traditional public schools, and they can't stay. So it's easy, you know, it's hard to get into a charter school, easy to get kicked out. In Chicago, what Mayor Emanuel calls the school network that has the secret sauce is a school network that has been charging families for misbehavior of their kids. So you get charged $5 per demerit. That school network has made over $400,000 off the backs of working families because of behavior issues. If you get too many demerits, you have to go to behavioral school during the summer. If you don't pay the amount, then you get kicked out, and they're not going to give you your papers to go to back into a public school system. And so what we see is we are dismantling the public school system, creating this new school system, and the federal government has played a really great role in ensuring that this happens at an accelerated rate by taking off the cap on charter schools with regard to race to the top monies. And so we are putting ourselves in this position, and it's so similar to what happened with No Child Left Behind, right? We set up this whole system of like what's a good school and what's not a good school. And now, you know, we're paying the price. And the kids who are the guinea pigs are children of color.
So one last question, and I want to end this questioning with something solutions oriented. We know that there aren't many solutions happening in Congress these days. There's a little bit of something called gridlock, and it's not because of our members, because when they were in power, things were moving, but I digress. This is not supposed to be partisan necessarily. So the White House announced the My Brother's Keeper initiative, which of course is a public-private partnership to ensure that African-American boys do succeed. But before there was My Brother's Keeper, there was 5,000 role models of excellence that Congressman Wilson started 21 years ago, 22 years ago. And there are other folks like Call Me Mister and the individuals that support programs like that that are all around this country. But I think where we kind of mess up is there's nothing to necessarily bridge those divides so that people can implement them? I know you said there needs to be call me Mr. in every state. So what types of things can our audience members here to do today to ensure that when we look back 60 years from now, we're not in the same exact place or worse off? That's really what this is about today. How do we ensure that there's real educational success, that there are more call me misters, that my brother's keeper isn't about just, you know, individual accountability and responsibility, but it's about engaging whole villages that it takes to raise our children?
Okay, I'm just gonna try to wrap a couple of my comments up into this. I think that—
I'm sorry, let's be brief. The audience is gonna kill me because they're family. I've told them that now, so they're gonna treat me like a family member. So let's be brief.
I'm always brief. So let me just say quickly, I think that accountability is critical. I think where there are already, let's say there's no new money, which is what everybody says, there's no new money. Where there's already money that's being given out, it's critical that there be accountability. Take the charter school situation, one-third of data shows, one-third are worse, perform worse in public schools, one-third on the same level, one-third are better. So clearly there is no data that shows that they're better. Judy mentioned with respect to that and about race to the top and money being given out there. So why not push for requirements in the through the competitive grant process, such as where data actually shows racial disparities exist, for example, with respect to curricula that Ivory just spoke about, or either discipline issues that Judy spoke about earlier? Why shouldn't those applicants have to submit action plans that demonstrate how they intend to actually eliminate the disparities that are evident in the civil rights data collection and their most recent data? That in and of itself won't prohibit the application, so you're not saying school district or school system, you can't apply, but if we're gonna give you this money, we're gonna hold you accountable to do something about it. Same situation is true, for example, with Title I funds. They exist, right? So when we talk about resources, I just want to dispel the notion that when you see a school that looks is dilapidated and, you know, a few blocks away there's one that looks great, like it's brand new, that school district could be all Title I. I work in a number of school systems in which the whole district is Title I, but the schools look like night and day. And why? That's because the systems are deciding how to allocate the resources, and largely that allocation falls in line with respect to the race of the student population in the school. So there's got to be some kind of accountability there as well. And I think I'm just going to offer those up as things that may be able to be done that don't require new funding.
I think we need to hit the reset button on the way that we are evaluating the situation of African Americans in public schools today. We all want public schools to survive. I passionately want public schools to survive. But I understand that probably the biggest threat to public schools are people taking their children out of public schools because they are afraid of public schools. And when we trace the reasons why we are afraid of public schools, it's a lot of times we have bought into certain types of propaganda. And until we stop buying into the propaganda, until we start to really understand what the numbers mean, you know, until we can look at NAEP scores and not look at it in the New York Times, but look at it on the federal government's website and understand what proficiency, lack of proficiency really mean, and understand what that means to our kids, until we start to really evaluate the numbers and the information that's being put at us and use that to help to make public schools better, not to take our children out of public schools and try charter schools, try private schools, try leaving the district, try using somebody else's address. You know, all of these types of things are helping to further the problems that we are having. We all can do something, and I remember when I worked at the federal penitentiary, and there was an inmate that came into my office and told me a simple thing of talk to the kids. And he told me talk to the kids because he said he never saw anyone like me growing up. And maybe if he saw someone like me growing up, he wouldn't be in that prison. And that motivated me to do research, to talk to the kids, to fight against this overrepresentation of black males in the criminal justice system. But I also believed in black males enough not to believe every piece of data that I saw in the newspaper. So with all of us in this room, you all are looking at this from a different vantage point than I am. Nobody else in this room is a deputy director of the White House Initiative on HBCUs. All of you all are doing something different. But all of you all are in a space where you can make a difference. So what I would challenge you all to do is to understand where you are and ask yourself, what can I do to stop the spread of misinformation and to make better opportunities for young black males?
So you threw me off because, because I'm a mother of a public school child who's in sixth grade, and I am struggling with this decision about whether or not to leave or not, because I believe the propaganda, because I know what is happening in the classrooms and in the schools. And I know that my child is not getting the teacher that has the experience that will challenge her to read great literature, but a Spanish teacher who can't speak Spanish.
Right. Our teacher teaches.
That's what my child in an all-black school gets.
Yeah.
So it's not about the data sometimes, right. But it's about what's knowing what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
But I, you know, so easy to say it, but I know that it is a real choice for people. And I am a believer in public schools, and that's why my child is still there, but I wonder whether or not I'm sacrificing her for my principles and my cause. And so I think that what it leaves us with, and it leaves me with, is every day trying to make the difference. One of the things that this administration has done that is incredible is this guidance on discipline, on school discipline. Because in the communities that we work with grassroots organizations, we are using the guidance that gives you the roadmap for what racial disparities and what discrimination and discipline looks like, and in order for the communities to have accountability. But I think that is the word accountability is where we have to be. We have to hold people accountable for our babies. And when I say our babies, I'm not just saying for me, my child, but for every child that is growing up in Prince George's County, I have to hold everyone accountable for what they are doing to our children. And that means if it is holding elected officials accountable, the school board, et cetera, we have to do that. Because there's no one really fighting on a level that we need to be for something that is immoral. We are socially bankrupt as a nation if we don't understand the kind of inequities that our children are living in. And so I think that we have got to challenge this administration on this race to the top and charter school crap and all the money that is coming with it, because it is wonderful, it seems great for everybody, but the money is not being directed in the right way. But we also have to, as Ivory said, be in each one of the places that we can be in to challenge what is happening for our children.
Oh, sorry, Dr. Jones, as a Hill staffer, I have to tell you that, former Hill staffer, when the member speaks, we have to defer, so I apologize. But. Oh, he can go first. Okay, so she's going to let you go first.
Well, that's in fact where I wanted to start, because I wanted to first thank Representative Wilson and other members of the CBC for this invitation to just come to be able to be a voice at the table in Washington. Our program began in 2000 under the Bush administration, where we were talking to 18-year-olds, trying to convince them why it was smart to consider being a third grade teacher, coming out of a K-12 elementary system that had every signaled in every which way that it was not a system for them. That's the same experience that that we have today. You know, we've got a K-12 system in South Carolina that in every way signals to them, to black boys, that it's not a system for you. And I have to, and I so admire Dr. Tolson's research. I've learned something every time I hear him. But you know, I'm in the trench where I'm seeing on a day-to-day basis how devastating our system is for these young men. So how do we maximize? How do we give hope, back you know, in a way that signals to them in every way that they're being challenged. And so what we have to do is that we have to stand in front of them. We have to say, look, you know, many of us are going to have to take the bullets, you know, real or imaginary, and be able to say that we've got to be able to withstand and stand tall for what we believe. And that is, and one of the things I want to make this clear, and I'll end with this, really, is that the 150 black males that we graduated, 95% of them come from South Carolina. 95% of them are still teaching and in the field. 95% of them are still in their neighborhoods, back in their communities, that are giving back to their neighborhoods. So I'm saying to you that, you know, it can work, and if they have something to believe in. And part of it is not to just get a degree and a certificate. That's not the issue. It's not getting a degree and a teaching certificate. It's about being able to go back into your community as men that with a college degree that is trying to give back in service for what they've received. Giving back is a big message in our program. You know, we're here in Washington. Most of our funds come from the state and other private sources. We don't benefit from waste at the top. I'm still trying to figure out what my brother's keeper is doing. I've got young men. I got a young man in as a principal that has taken his school, Title I, the poorest demographic in Orangeburg County, from a failing school with a 34.5 aggregate test score on a state testing. To in 1 year to a 94.5, from an F school to an A school in 1 year, in a poor demographic. And I'm not understanding why, you know, where's the cavalry? You know, people are saying out of Washington that, you know, we're looking for what works. And we're in South Carolina, we've got Congressman Clyburn, you know, who advocates for, I'm not surprised, I'm happy, Representative Wilson, that he's been an advocate for Call Me Mister. But the cavalry is not coming from Washington. So we've got to figure out how to solve our problems in South Carolina. You know, who knows what the new administration is going to be? You know, but we can't stop. You know, Mister stands for mentors instructing students toward effective role models. We're producing teachers, educators that are standing tall. It's now cool to be a Mister. It's as cool and cooler to be a Mister than it is to be a linebacker at Clemson. I'm proud of that. You know, so that was a big turnaround. You know, and so because most of us can't play quarterback. You know, and so that's the deal. And giving back is real important for us. You know, and being able to do it in the right way. We're looking for commitments. You know, I'm not looking for a support for a program. I'm looking for support for the transformation of a community. You know, that's what we're here for. That's why I came to Washington.
That's great. And hopefully the folks in the audience have heard that. Now you all can thank Congresswoman Wilson, because she is deferring her remarks so that you all can ask a couple of questions. Before we do that, I need to recognize someone who was on a school board for 10 years before becoming mayor. Congressman Scott brought to my attention that we have Alexandria Mayor Bill Yule with us today. And I don't know if you had a question or if it's just recognition. You're not asking a question. Okay. Well, thank you so much for being with us today. You do have a question. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Can you say your name and where you're from?
Stand up.
Yes, and now we have from Congressman Wilson, stand up. And please make sure you ask a question. I do have the mic, so I will interrupt you just so that we can make sure we get to questions. Yes, ma'am.
Programs, but it seems to me in Alabama, especially in Montgomery, where I'm a freshman me being here and posting pictures, the whole Montgomery is amazed that I can be in Washington because they don't believe they could be there. And one of you guys mentioned image. I look around and I'm like, these don't look like none of my people. You know, my people are the baby mamas, the drug dealers, the dropouts. Like, how can, before we even get to education, I think we should get the black image back where it should be. Before it was, you know, not just pumping the fist, but they happen to be a black woman. And, you know, the struggles that we came from, like, how can we get that started before we even talk about sending our kids to school where they're constantly reminded that they don't have, you know, that you don't have this. You know, your mom didn't graduate high school, so you're not going to be this. Your mom didn't go to college. So, like, how can you motivate them to even care about going to school when all they think they're going to be a baby mama? Like, why should I go to school?
Right. Let's do one answer so we can get to more questions.
I think your experience is similar to a lot of us in Washington, D.C., because, you know, a lot of us are transplants like you. I'm from Baton Rouge, Louisiana, which is probably very similar to Montgomery, Alabama. You know, my best friend from high school went to prison around the same time I was going to college. There was someone who was killed in front of me at the school that I went to. So I understand the mentality that you're talking about. And, you know, I think about that inmate that came to me and said, talk to the kids. That's exactly what he was getting at. So we all have a part to play. We have to be able to be in a position to believe in these kids. And there's no easy answer. But I do encourage everyone who is in any type of position where they are touching, in a position where they could actually talk to these kids, to not look at them as someone who is a problem or at risk, to constantly look for what's right about them and build on their strengths. We also need to understand who's getting it right. So if you have to talk to 10 kids before you find one kid that figures it out, find that one kid, because that's the kid that has the answer. I've published almost 100 different articles. But the kid who's actually living in that situation and has figured it out, that's the kid that we need to talk to because they have the answers. I'm going to close on this. A lot of the strategies that we try to promote to these kids are middle class based strategies. For example, stay away from the wrong crowd. That doesn't make any sense to a kid in a densely populated area. They can't stay away from the wrong crowd. I couldn't stay away from the wrong crowd. I couldn't stay away from my friend because he made a bad decision. What kids do who are in those situations and they make it out, they find a way to influence the wrong crowd. If they can't be able to communicate with that crowd and still be successful, then they will fail themselves. They will either become the wrong crowd or they become a victim to the wrong crowd. So it's a type of charisma that they have to develop at a very young age. That's just one example of ways in which we need to look at things from their vantage point, not the middle class vantage point.
Angela.
Yes, sir.
There are things ministers can do with all this. We're legislators. There's specific things that we can do as legislators. And one is to promote programs like Upward Bound and Gear Up that establish an expectation that you're going to college. And then you grab the kids in the 10th grade and you just change your expectation, you're not going to be a baby mama, and you're going to college. And there are things, and we're not funding Upward Bound nearly as we should, not funding Gear Up and these other programs, but they work and change that expectation.
I see you all, but I had some other hands that I'm going to get to first, but I see all of you. Yes, sir, in the back.
Hi, my name is Ray Baker with Emmy Magazine. My question is about solutions, and this question that I have, we know that there's partisan gridlock here in Washington, D.C., so legislatively there may be some challenges with regards to funding. So what are some solutions that community members and parents can implement themselves outside of Dr. Tolson's just now allusion to no longer having middle-class philosophies to inspire our children?
In two areas, so Advancement Project works in specifically on the school-to-prison pipeline. It's important to know that particular issue around the school-to-prison pipeline actually got into the national narrative and discussion and all the way to the White House because of grassroots groups. Parents and students themselves
who have been fighting discriminatory discipline issues and criminalization at a very local level. And so there are groups across the country that are working on this issue. We worked, for example, in Broward County, Florida, where we've worked with the school system and community to change how discipline is being done. And in a year, we have seen the suspensions come down by 65%. We've seen the arrests come down by 40%, but it was a very community-driven process around holding the school system accountable. We were able to do that in Buffalo, New York, where an African-American male was wandering the school, the hallways in school one day, and was told that he was going to be suspended. They put him out of the school. He didn't wait for his mom to come pick him up. He was killed in a drive-by shooting. And as a result, the community said, wait a second, school is where our children are supposed to be, and so we're not going for these suspensions any longer. So, you know, it really has been this movement around the school-to-prison pipeline has been because parents, young people, impacted young people have decided enough. The same with the school closings. There's the group that we're working, Journey for Justice Alliance. You can find their website. They are working in 22 cities with parents and young people who are fighting school closings and the privatization of schools. So we can, as community members, play a really important role in reforming these issues.
Okay. Oh, do I have Congresswoman Wilson?
I wasn't going to say anything, but I just have to say
something. It doesn't work.
I found that you have to engage the entire community in helping these young boys get on the right track. When I say the entire community, I'm talking about the public defender's office. I'm talking about the state attorney's office. I'm talking about the colleges and universities in your county. I'm talking about the school system. Every single solitary person who you have to make them significant in the lives of these children, because what we're talking about in this room, people talk about at home. They talk about this all the time. When a black boy is standing on the corner and white people pass in a car, or black people pass in a car, everyone locks their doors. So there's no reason to try to pretend that these children are not victims. They're victims while shopping, walking down the street, playing ball, just being themselves. They're just victims. And this has a lot to do with this gentleman has told us from the HBCUs from the White House. Now, I want to tell you that I'm not going to say that this is something that could be done nationwide, but in 1990, Lamar Alexander was the Secretary of Education. The first Daddy Bush was the President of the United States, and they had to select one school in the nation that was the America 2000 school for the nation. And I had a school that had 900 elementary children in it, and they selected my school. They came to the school and designated it as the American 2000 school of the year. And let me tell you why. When I first went to the school, it was during the time of the Mariel boat lift, where they were bringing the Cubans in from Cuba. And so the school was basically Hispanic. They were busing in black children. That was the other one third that I told you about. And the people who lived in the community were white people. So the community began to change, because the Cuban people were coming in and the white people didn't want to live with the Cuban people. And they didn't want the black children bust into the school. Everybody started to shift in this neighborhood moving kind of thing. So that gave me the opportunity. Like you said, teachers left. Every single teacher that I hired in that school, this is what I said to them. I said, I will hire you, But if you have minor children that are in K through sixth grade, it was sixth grade at that time, you have to bring them to this school. I say, because if this school is good enough for you to work in, then with other people's children, then you've got to bring your children to the school. So the next thing I knew, all of these people were bringing that. I said, you know, I like you. This isn't personal, but I'm not going to hire you unless you register your children. So I'm not advocating that everybody do this because it was kind of illegal. So what I did was, the next thing you knew, the school, everybody couldn't understand how all of these children got along so well, what was going on. We'd be at the school till 9 o'clock at night. The children would be playing basketball. And so when Lamar Alexander came to the school and he asked me, How did you get this school like this? And I told him. And the superintendent told me as they were driving away from the school in a limousine, oh, what a wonderful world it would be if every school were like Skyway. Now, just think about it. During the integration, here you have a white mother. She's running way over here to drop off her white children. And then she's coming to Skyway. Then you got this Cuban mother, she's way over here, she's dropping her child. I said, bring them with you, if it's good enough. And so the school just flourished and flourished. And you know what? It's the same today. Flourishing, nobody left the community, nobody left the school, because everybody fell in love with it. Now, I'm gonna tell you, when I went to the school board and I tried to do that the same way I tried to do the role models, I had more success in setting up the role models program than in getting people to bring the children to the school because of racism. They didn't want them in that particular community. They wanted them in the suburbs. I'm not talking about my school. I'm talking about the other schools across the county. But this was not a school. This was a Title I school. That was the America 2000 school for the nation. Google it. You'll see Mr. Lamar Alexander. So that's all I wanted to say. And thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Wilson. So we're way over time. I know I see your hands towering up, but I promise I have an order to this. See, there's levels to this. Hold on. I have it. Yes, ma'am, I saw you next, and you can state your name, where you're from, and a very quick question, because we're way over time. If folks have to leave, we understand. To the extent that the panel can stay, we'll continue to engage. Yes, ma'am. No, we're not. We're 30 minutes over. I'm sorry. No, I should have been on the mic. I was talking.
My name is as a young professional starting out in my career, really passionate about education reform and really wanting to change the school to prison pipeline, what can I do in the legal field to really maximize my impact as an agent for change?
I'll be quick, and I can definitely follow up with you after because there may be some other questions, but I would say this. I consider myself, I could be an education lawyer. I do not consider myself an education lawyer, although I've taught the class multiple times. I consider myself a civil rights advocate. So I think that you need to think carefully about the framing of what it is that you want to do so that you are able to advocate for the issues that you want to advocate for, whether it's racial justice or justice for others who are historically disenfranchised in the country. But I don't want to take up that much time, Saul.
Can I say yep. that a lot of people you can sue on the achievement gap, whether or not maintaining the achievement gap is legal, the suspensions, whether or not the zero tolerance foolishness is legal, particularly as applied, things like equity and funding, there are a whole lot of real live legal issues. We need more lawyers bringing lawsuits. The Legal Defense Fund is bringing a lot of them, but the more the merrier.
He means that he's one of the brightest legal minds in the caucus, so you might want to go sit with him. on that. Okay. The answer is sue somebody. I had one question. No, there's you right here with the gray suit on. Yes, go ahead. So Ivory, give him a primer, and then after this, you guys are going to take this offline,
okay.
So we can get
yeah,
another question.
Yeah, I'm actually on another forum at 5 o'clock.
Oh, well, then so, there's that.
And it's not in this building. So the thing about it is, you know, most children in the United States go to public schools. There are public schools out there that seem to be serving families very, very well. Most white people they like the public schools in their districts, you know, in predominantly white districts. And, you know, in fact, a lot of, you know, black families try to get into predominantly white districts because the public schools are supposed to be bad. So it's not about public schools versus charter schools. It's only public schools versus charter schools when it comes to black people, if we, you know, be honest about it. But one of the things we need to understand is that there are some things we need to look for in a good school. But a lot of times the information that's being put out there is not really information that helps us to make the best choices. So we don't want to send our kids to a school where everybody's getting suspended and they have zero tolerance policies. We don't want to send our kids to a school where there is problems with violence and they can't get a handle on it. We don't want to send our kids to school that has no AP classes, no honors classes, no advanced math or science classes. We don't want to send our kids to a school where they think that extracurricular activity is just something completely unnecessary and the only thing they do is teach to a test. But a lot of times, you know, we don't want a school to teach to the test, but a lot of times the data that gets out there is actually test information. And that's the only thing that we're basing it on. And so we end up starving schools with a lot of good potential because we aren't using the best information in order to make a good decision on how to get there. We'd love to talk more about it.
So before Ivory leaves, quickly want to thank our distinguished panel and also the CBC and the member hosts who are still here. Okay, I'm going to get to him, but I'm just thanking you, Congresswoman, before everybody leaves. Congresswoman Wilson, Congressman Danny Davis, Congressman Bobby Scott, and Congressman Hank Johnson. Yes, sir, the Congresswoman said call on you. You are next.
Y'all see
her
on TV, don't you?
Oh, no. Don't do that. No, we don't have to do that.
A lot of it.
Mm-hmm. That's your final answer?
Yeah, I mean, I think, I mean, I think, yeah, I think what I said to the previous question really fits into that. I think the information that we're getting about public schools is not really designed for us to make the best decisions about whether public schools are good or not. And it's because, you know, we, a lot of times we like to be spoon-fed information, but the best information you need to research. So if the only thing you're doing is looking at a great school score, greatschools.com score, then you're not gonna understand a whole lot about that school. I think we do need to rebuild trust in public schools if we want to save it. And that's not to say that we need to allow every public school to just do what they do. But I've already talked about some of the indicators that I think is very important for us to look at. But a lot of times that's not what we're looking at when we evaluate them.
So Congresswoman Wilson has an answer, and then we're going to do one final question.
I was just going to say follow the money. That's all you have to do. And it started with Governor Jeb Bush of Florida. And he started putting grades on schools through testing. And to this day, no one can understand the whole process of the test and how it affects how a school gets a grade. I represented a very wealthy district called Miami Shores. And the first year that the test was given, they made a D. So when I got to my office that morning, everyone was in the parking lot, all the people, does that mean we have a D country club? Does that mean I'm a D parent? I said, call the governor, go see the governor. Nobody did anything. They went to see the governor, they called the governor, they wrote letters, they crashed his computer, everything you could possibly do to get his attention. They didn't fire any teachers. They didn't do anything to Miami Shores Elementary School. Miami Shores Elementary School stayed the same. The next year, Miami Shores Elementary School was an A. I found out that for the third grade in Florida, they have 60 different tests for the third graders. Everyone in this room thinks that all of the children take the same test. So one day I went to the Department of Education with my aide and we looked at every single test. It took us a whole day without eating lunch to put into order from the hardest to the easiest test. The hardest third grade test nobody in this room could pass. The easiest third grade test, a first grader could pass it. So that's how many tests there were. My question to the Department of Education in Florida and to Governor Bush was, who determines which school gets which tests? To this day, no one has been able to answer that question. I wrote the federal government and asked them to come in and to audit the FCAT in Florida because it was spreading. Once he started it in Florida with these grades and getting all of this done, I asked our, what's the chairman of the education committee? Klein? Not Mr. Klein, the ranking member.
George Miller.
I asked Mr. George Miller when I first got here, I said, you've got to help me. We've got to find out who determines, who makes the decision as to who, which test goes to which school. Now you think about what I just told you. So if you didn't pass the third grade test, you were retained. And as you are retained, the Department of Justice in Florida is using your third grade retention to determine how many prisons they're gonna build for you when you get grown. So to this day, no one still knows. But we do know that if a child is retained, that when the psychologist who works for the 5,000 role models, the hardest thing for a child is, number one, the loss of a parent, if a parent dies. The second biggest heartbreak is school retention. So when you retain a child, you have destroyed him. You have destroyed him. And when I asked Governor Bush, I said, what is going to happen to these thousands of little third graders that are being retained because they failed the test on one day? He said, they will be casualties of the war. So I say, what war? He said, the war on education, because I'm going to change this.
Well, and that's what he did. Really boils down to non-profit school industry and the for-profit prison industrial complex. And those two work hand in hand. And so there is a scheme that has been underway for at least 30 years that is designed to crush the public schools, turn them into private schools, for profit,
take taxpayers' money, put it into private hands, and then for those who cannot survive that, they have the prison system, which is turning into a situation where people work in order to get credit for good time, and also, you know, you make a dollar an hour, $1.07 an hour, and you're producing goods that are then sold retail at Walmart and other places like this. So it's really a scheme that that has been underway for quite some time, and we're going to have to break the cycle of it.
And the person who owns the software that they sell to Florida each year for billions of dollars is Neil Bush, the brother of Jeb Bush. Have written about that in the newspaper and every magazine, and still, he still sells the thing. What can we do? Sometimes I think about just going out, and I say this all the time, and maybe one day I might have to do it. We have a big street in Miami called Biscayne Boulevard. And I sometimes just want to go out there and stand in the middle of the street and stop every car and say, I'm not moving, kill me, hit me, until you listen to what they're doing to these children.
That's what we
got to
do.
It's unbelievable.
Okay, we have one final question. And you all have been so patient. Just give us one more minute. Yes, ma'am. One answer from the panel. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. And I will be try to be quick. Good afternoon. My name is Tyra Beeman. I'm a rising junior at Spelman College. And this is for the panelists or the members who were HBCU graduates.
One answer.
For me at Spelman College, I found that there's a bubble around Spelman and the surrounding area in the West End. And a lot of the issues, I know Dr. Tolson stated, we need to rewrite our narrative. But how do we rewrite our narrative if we don't know our narrative? We don't know the issues in our West End community. We don't know what these individuals need because we're so busy just giving to them, passing out to the homeless, or giving to the students when we have a minute of our time, but we don't actually engage with the individuals in these communities. My first question is...
No, you have one question.
Yeah, so when did this begin, the distinction between these HBCU communities and the surrounding community, and what do we do to create one cohesive community in between the Western community or these disenfranchised communities and the schools that we go to?
I'm going to let that pass as 1A and 1B, but that was two questions. Yes, yes, panel. You're passionate. I like your passion, Spelman. Oh, Mr. Davis.
I graduated from an HBCU. But I also read a fellow named Frederick Douglass before I got there. And he taught that struggle, strife, and pain are the prerequisites for change. Mm-hmm. And if there is no struggle, there is no progress.
Mm-hmm.
There's no one way to do it, but struggle has to be at the core. And if you don't struggle, you don't succeed.
Oh, yes.
Also, the involvement of the community, in my area, Hampton University, one dean was served in the House of Delegates, another dean is now in the State Senate. I mean, there is involvement in the community. But I mean, I think we may have a lot of complaints about what these local school boards are doing. I'd like some of these people, I mean, if I have another advice to the Harvard lawyers,
to be
for the school board. I mean, about anybody in here is about as smart as anybody that's representing you on the school board. You could, I mean, some of these people that run and get elected to the school board, no wonder students are messed up. We need people, rather than to complain, run for the school board, and then you make the decision and let them complain about you. We can't sit up here and let these people run for the school board without the background, without the interest in the children, and then sit back and wonder what happened. We have to make sure that we're running good candidates, and if you can't find somebody, then you got to run yourself.
Well, to our Harvard sister, Mr. Davis just said, without struggle, there is no progress, quoting the great Frederick Douglass. You will definitely be struggling on the school board, especially if you take out student loans, so watch that. That said, ladies and gentlemen, it has been wonderful to spend the afternoon with you, continue the struggle, continue to support our members. Thank you so much for your time.
I really appreciate your remarks.
appreciate the work that you're doing.
My daughter, we have one black male teacher in her school, and everybody loves that teacher.
It's not uncommon. Hey, thank you, brother. Appreciate it.
Sure.
Yeah, that's a story everywhere.
He's got this like interest in the kids beyond.